What up though, I'm Murs, HipHopDX, and this is The Breakdown.
With hip hop and R&B surpassing rock as the most popular genre of music in the United States, rap is now technically pop or popular music. So I felt like it might be time to redefine how we classify the music of our culture.
So what I've come up with is a three-lane theory. There's the pop lane, the hip-hop lane, and the hip-hop lane. The pop for artists like Drake, the hip-hop for artists like Kendrick Lamar, the hip-hop for artists like J. Cole. Now don't get it fucked up. All three of them are amazing, real, true hip-hop artists. They care more about being dope than they do their record sales. But since mainstream and conscious rap are doing numbers, I feel those terms are irrelevant. Thus, my three-lane theory. Let's break it down. J. Cole, Kendrick Lamar, Drake, the three kings of this new era. Proof that in this new era, being a true lyricist can be lucrative. Yes, this new era also birthed mumble rap, but for all the hype, you can't name me one of those dudes who have two platinum albums or even one sold out arena tour. These three have all done it, but in case you've been in a coma, and just for shits and giggles, I'ma run down the resume. Kendrick Lamar, Section 80, gold. Good Kid, over a million. To Pimp a Butterfly, over a million. Damn, already over 2 million. Current tour, damn, selling out arenas nationwide. J. Cole, Cole World, platinum. Born Sinner, platinum. 2014 Forest Hills Drive, double platinum. For Your Eyes Only, platinum. And currently, the For Your Eyes Only tour is selling out arenas nationwide. Drake, sheesh. Thank Me Later, platinum. Take Care, 4 times platinum. Nothing Was the Same, triple platinum. Views, 4 times platinum. Last Summer's Revenge tour crushed box offices nationwide. And there you have it, facts. And from these facts, we can see that October's very own Mr. Aubrey Drake Graham outsells the other two artists by leaps and bounds. Because he is king of the pop lane. But before Mr. OVO, this lane had zero credibility when it came to lyrics. It was a bunch of dudes using rap music as a form of entertainment. Rappers with zero to novice level talent, with no message, no movement. Unless you're talking about moving units or getting people to move their ass on the dance floor. And while Drake cares about selling records and getting people to dance, he's still able to hit you with lyrics like this.
A lot of y'all are still sounding like last year. The game need changing. I'm cashier, nickels for my thoughts, dimes in my bed, quarters of the lines in my head.
The lane used to be reserved for one-hit wonders, such as Vanilla Ice, Soulja Boy,
now I mean you.
Crank that song.
Now I mean you.
Or more recently, Silento.
Now watch me, Will. Now watch me, Nana.
Okay. But this lane has been dominated by acts like MC Hammer.
Can't touch this.
Nelly,
it's getting hot in here, so hot, so take off all your clothes.
And Flo Rida.
None
of these artists were ever in danger of making a hip hop quotable in the Source magazine, being invited to a BET cypher, or making anyone's top 5 dead or alive. Then along comes Drake. And even his dude's Sprite commercial could be a candidate for verse of the year. Look, on the real, he changed it all. He's been able to be a full-fledged pop star, yet maintain his credibility as a real lyricist. His influences range from Kanye.
Always took the time to listen to Kanye's music and appreciate it beyond just, you know, beyond, like, we really search the samples and we find out, like, where his inspiration comes from, because he has one of the best ears in music, period.
To Fonte.
Fonte is definitely one of my favorite rappers, yeah.
So when it comes to the culture, the boy knows this shit. Side note, I believe Fonte greatly influenced all three of these artists, because before him, no one was able to go from R. Kelly to Rakim on the same track. But back to Drake. His influences are just as diverse as his features. He can work with Rihanna, who are virtually unknown vocalists from Africa like Wizkid, and it's always gonna be danceable, radio friendly, and most likely a smash hit. All while not damaging the lyrical legitimacy he's brought to the pop lane. You can knock his sappy lyrics or his lack of street cred, but you cannot deny his dedication to the craft, nor his dedication to dominating the charts. The boy knows his lane and he does not deviate ever. While the other two artists have switched lanes once or twice, let's take Cole. His debut album, Cole World, the first single is pop as fuck, even contains an interpolation of a Paula Abdul song.
And while it went double platinum, the rest of the album was more in line with what we call the hip hop lane, where the lyrics definitely have some substance and a heartfelt message, but it's surrounded by a polished production and pop features like Drake and Missy Elliott.
A lot of artists do this as a compromise with the label in order to get the release date, or as an attempt to bring the mainstream into their message. But straddling the fence is a delicate art, and as Cole put it on his second album, sometimes you run the risk of letting Nas down.
The second album, Born Sinner, was less poppy, but still had some of the big name features and gloss from the first album. Crooked Smile featuring TLC is a perfect example of a heartfelt message mixed with some pop elements to placate the mainstream listener.
And it worked. The young man from Fayetteville moved the needle again and got more platinum plaques. But as he tells us on Let Nas Down, it was all part of a bigger plan. Take a listen.
Apologies to OGs for sacrificing my art, but I'm here for a greater purpose. I knew right from the start.
And that plan came to fruition as he switched lanes and went the pure hip-hop route. No marketing plan, no features, no polished production geared towards the radio. He just stuck to his vision. And that, in a nutshell, is the definition of the hip-hop lane. When an MC says, here's my work, either y'all fuck with it or y'all don't. It doesn't get any more B-boy than that. And it's a risk when you're as competitive as I feel these three artists are. Taking the pure hip-hop route could slow you down. But for Cole, it worked. 2014 Forest Hills Drive became his fastest selling, most successful album to date. So successful, in fact, that with his next release, he decided to keep the same formula. And For Your Eyes Only, see what he did there? Fourth album, For Your Eyes. Anyway, it too is already certified platinum. Now let's talk Kung Fu Kenny from Compton. His first album, Section 80, for sure in the hip hop lane. A pre-Cole world, J. Cole was the most popular producer on the album. And there was definitely a strong message to the project. It took almost 3 years for this project to go gold, a testament to what I said about the pure hip hop lane. While providing a solid foundation, it can slow you down. Fast forward, 1 year, one Drake tour, and a Dr. Dre co-sign later, we have Good Kid, Mad City, which is a switch over to the hip hop lane with bigger producers like DJ Khalil, Just Blaze, and Pharrell. With features from Dr. Dre and even another look from the king of pop hop himself, Drizzy Drake, on a song that had a well-known R&B sample. Now, what separates hip-hop from full-blown pop is that its intent isn't to make you dance, but as I said before, draw people in. And switching lanes from hip-hop to hip-pop brought K-Dot mucho success, 1.6 million and counting. This lane made him the top-selling male hip-hop artist of 2012. So what does he do for his next LP? Switch it up again, back to the hip-hop lane. To Pimp a Butterfly drops with no rollout, no huge features, this project sounded nothing like anything the other mainstream acts were doing. And while it did less number sales-wise than the albums released by Cole and Drake around the same time, it did wind up with 11 Grammy noms and a win for Best Rap Album. After this was Untitled Unmastered, which to me was basically him pulling all the way over to the shoulder of the hip-hop lane and throwing the hazards on. But I don't count this as an official album. It's similar to the Yours Truly EPs or the More Life playlist, just a bunch of extras from the previous album that didn't make the cut. Then there was Damn, and it hit out of nowhere. But this album was a solid switch back to the hip hop lane, with the two first singles, Humble and DNA, being produced by Mike Will Made It, and the third single featuring the pop queen Rihanna in a video fit for an IMAX release. Pop as fuck, right? But then he gets Kid Capri, legendary hip-hop DJ, to host the whole album. Hip-hop is fuck, right? And on the song Element, he says, roll the clip, James.
Cause most of y'all ain't real, most of y'all go squeal, most of y'all just envy, but jealousy get you killed. Most of y'all throw rocks and try to hide your hand. Just say his name and I promise that you'll see Candyman. Because it's all in your eyes, most of y'all tell lies. Most of y'all don't fade, most of y'all been advised. Last OP I tried to lift a black artist, but it's a difference between black artists and whack artists.
Partly a tip to J Electronica, but I feel like the brunt of the weight was for Drake and Big Sean. I feel like the whole album is saying, look, motherfuckers, if I want to, I could come over to your lane, outsell you, and still be woke than a motherfucker. And it seems to be true, because after only 2 months, Damn is already certified double platinum. Look, I'm not taking sides, I'm a fan of them all, and I appreciate the new heights they've taken the culture to. But being a true student of the art form, I have to acknowledge that these three aren't the first credible lyricists to become household names. There's been LL Cool J, Ice Cube, Ice-T, Tupac, and Jay-Z before them. But aside from Jay, All of the other artists had to go outside of the culture and use TV or film to fuel or maintain their iconic status. But Cole, Kendrick, and Drake have very much stuck to the craft. They've built their respective empires solely on beats and rhymes, and I, for one, love them for it. You may say that they're too soft. You may say that they sing too much. You may say so-and-so's voice is annoying, but you can't say that they don't spit. And we as the rap community must accept that we're on top now. We are popular music. And with that, we may have to broaden our definition of what real rap is. Just because something's on the radio every 5 minutes or it sells millions doesn't mean it's not quality anymore. Yeah, these three have become mainstream artists. But contrary to their predecessors, I don't feel like they've been caught up in the bullshit that comes along with being a success. In fact, I think they changed the direction of the mainstream and maybe even purified it a bit. So shouldn't we be thanking them for bringing artistic integrity back to popular music? I say hell yeah. You might say fuck no, but before we talk about it in the comments below, where do you think your favorite artist fits in the three-lane theory? Big Sean, I love his growth as an MC, but I definitely say pop. 2 Chainz, I would definitely say his first 2 albums were pop, but currently hip-hop. What about Tyler? His music and subject matter abstract as fuck, or is it pop because he uses it all to sell shoes, clothes, and socks? And let's not forget, he's been the only MC to have his own TV show recently. Logic, Joey Badass, definitely hip hop, right? What about Mac Miller? Super creative music and definitely can spit, but he is dating one of the biggest pop stars in the world and she is of course featured on his new album. So does that take him out of the hip hop lane? Gucci, he's never gone platinum on his own, but he's had songs with Mariah Carey, Fifth Harmony, Drake, Jamie Foxx, Ray Swarmer. Does that make him pop? Then we get to the vets. 50, Jay, Weezy, and dare I ask about Eminem. Self-proclaimed rap god, yet he has features from pop queen Rihanna on his last 2 albums. Does that make him pop? Honestly, it's just music. Either you enjoy it or you don't. Me personally, I'm happy as fuck that rap music is on top right now. It's a huge middle finger to all the old motherfuckers who used to tell me it was just a fad. So let's enjoy this victory. And if you're anything like me, the fun part is having these silly ass debates deciding who fits where. So ladies and gentlemen, I give to you my three-lane theory. Let's have at it. And as always, for more music and news, check out HipHopDX.com.